Hello folks, thank you very much for joining us here today. Today, 7th of February, is the feast day of St. Loman. Today we are going to unveil a nice wooden sculpture to commemorate the St. Loman's Hospital in Mullingar here, to think of and remember the patients that lived here, patients that died here, and that are buried in the hospital cemetery, as well as the staff that worked here. The wooden sculpture, when we unveil it, is a very beautiful piece carved by local wood sculptor Richie Clark. I will bring you through the emblems and symbols on it so that they all mean something and explain what they meant to us. We wrote the book back in 2014 from the staff point of view, and we sold it throughout the town, throughout the country. Now, just to remind you all, as I'm sure you well know, St. Loman, born somewhere around the year 600 AD, was born somewhere out along the west side of Loch Oul, where his father owned land. He set up a monastery there. He was a priest, and around the time of the Great Drought, which they tell us, the history will tell us that around the year 680 AD, St. Loman was asked by the locals to save them in the event of the drought and the disease that followed. So it's said that he got his plough, he ploughed a furrow around the parish, and everyone within that was saved from that pandemic, and they said every pandemic ever since. Now, I can't verify that. So this building here, the main building, was built 1855, called the Mullingar District Asylum. It remained that name until somewhere into the 1920s, where the popular thing in Ireland was for every asylum to change the name to the local mental hospital. So places like Bannisloe, Kev St. Bridget's, here of course. There were three suggestions of what saint they would use. Now, Jerry Lestrange was a local councillor, lots of you probably know the name. He suggested St. Loman. St. Mel's and St. Fechlin were also suggested. And the vote came down, St. Loman won out by 9 votes. So from the 11th of September 1959, the building was renamed St. Loman's Hospital. So that's the day it was born, let's say. So to go any further, we're going to have to unveil this wood sculpture. And for that, I'm going to call on the 5 others, the authors of the book, The History of St. Loman's Hospital in Changing Times. So Frank Breffney, Anne is here, yes, Joe. So if you come, Margaret, come this way. How are you? Go on, some step here. Stay on this.
Just get ready.
Now folks, I think you'll have to agree, this is a lovely piece of wood sculpture. It's, we asked Richie Clark, which is here. Richie, a local wood sculptor, has done a lot of work. You're probably aware of his work, familiar with the town park. We got him to do this. Now Richie has connections with the hospital here because obviously his mother and father, you will know Dick Clark, Etty Clark, who were on the nursing staff here for many years. So we had to unveil it now because I'd like to just bring you through some of the symbols there that I'd like to explain what they mean to us. St. Loman's Hospital itself, as I said, gave you that little bit of history of the hospital. 1855, it was decided that a mental hospital was needed in the Midlands. A guy by the name of John Skipton Mulvaney was employed as the architect. He's also well known for work that he had done the Royal St. George Yacht Club in Dunleary, Broadstone Rail Station or train station in Dublin. He also did the Mullingar train station. He did Athlone, He did Culloden, I think, yes, and Galway station, along with what we know as the Great Southern Hotel in Galway. So we came here, he was asked to build it to house 300 inmates. It will be called the Mullingar Lunatic Asylum. And it remained a centre of care for some 158 years up until the 4th of December 2013, when the last patients that were cared for in the old block in St. Edna's Ward transferred to this building just here behind us, which had just been refurbished. Very quickly after building, it became apparent that the numbers were rising. Our first patients here were female patients who transferred from the Richmond Asylum at the time, later St. Brendan's Hospital in Dublin. They came few at a time and populated the first of the wards. Overcrowding within 20 years became an issue. What was happening is the local jails, each town would have had its own jail. And the rules allowed for so-called lunatics that were in the jail to be transferred to the mental hospital. And so it happened. Also, the same thing happened from the workhouses. So the numbers started rising, extensions were needed. Things were happening, like water supply was a problem. So they had to deal with that. Sewerage, the heat and dampness. Along came the next architect, a guy by the name of George Wilkinson. Now George had come from, an Englishman, had come from England, and his role in Ireland was to set up and design the workhouses. And he's credited with almost all the workhouses. Now it's strange maybe that the first job he got here, the first assignment here, was to deal with the heat, or the lack of it, and the dampness. He was after coming from the workhouses where he had been criticised greatly for the earlier ones. Too much ventilation, inmates or patients, whatever, were dying of the cold over the winter. The second wave, he tried to correct that and he closed it up, and the opposite happened. People were dying because of disease spreading and there was no lack of ventilation. So how we got the job here to deal with the ventilation and the heat in this establishment, but anyway, he did it. He promised the board that he could deliver more heat for less cost. And that went down well with them, so they employed him. And he installed stoves in all the wards, and highly effective. Later, he was employed to build the extensions that we know off the back, say they're like St. Catherine's, St. Finian's, St. Finbar's. The requirement at the time, because cholera was prevalent in the country at the time, each of those should be a standalone building. There were later years joined up by either other wards or corridors back onto the main building. So later than that again, Mr. Wilkinson was employed to design the Roman Catholic Chapel. The Reverend Dr. Woodlock from, he was the President Bishop of Meath, and he proposed that a chapel be built for the Catholic inmates. And George Wilkinson was given the design assignment. Now the Society of Architects of Ireland have written that George Wilkinson never designed a church or a commercial business. So we were able to, with our research here, we had the proof in the books we have where he was employed and where he actually got paid for doing the job. So we were able to correct their books for them. And later it was found that he also designed the church in Grange Gorman. So that's our St. Lomas. Now the hands, as you see, the caring hands, the tool of all tools have been described as. We would like to think of it here as the care that was provided by the people that worked here to the people that needed this care. And the hospital I have spoken about, which brings me around, because when I talk about the heat and that, it brings us on to the big chimney. Because as the hospital grew, obviously more heat was required, more buildings. And the big chimney, or the tall chimney as it's known locally, it's a well-known landmark obviously on the Mullingar landscape. The badge, what we call the badge, this is what's called the nurse training badge. It represents the hospital. This is a copy of, say, one that was recommissioned by the Midland Health Board and partnership in the late 1990s. We have the symbol of the three counties, We have the swan from representing Westmeath. We have the Bishop West representing Longford, and the King, of course, representing County Meath. The crucifix here represents the graveyard. It represents the 1,256 people who were buried there. Now, you might note 1,257 is written on it. That is because we purposely went with one more than the number of people there, so that number does not correspond with any person. The oak at the bottom, so we have the oak leaves and the acorn, that kind of symbol again of strength, of courage. It links back in maybe with the hands at the top. Again, that the symbol of hope for the people who are here, who come through here, who were treated from here, have some hope at the end. So for now, that's the few words I have, and I think I'll call on Tim before I finish. Tim has a few words to say. Thank you. Right, are we ready to go?
Good afternoon, everyone. Well, I got off, for those of you that don't know me, my name is Tim Shrahan. I'm an assistant director of nursing here, and I got a call from Audrin last week just to say a few words on behalf of the hospital management here. Anthony Coyne is the area director of nursing here, and he sends his regards. He can't unfortunately be here this evening, but he would have loved to have been here. So the honour falls to me, and when I say the word honour, I mean it, because I was delighted when Audrin gave me a call. And I want to acknowledge the work of the six individuals, Joe, Audrin, Breffley, Margaret, and Frank, and Anne, on really an outstanding piece of work that you have achieved, both in the incredible piece that you did with the book, and achieving a publication of really a landmark piece of work associated with this hospital and service. And I think it's testament to the people that you are, that I have known. I came to work here in 2002, so relatively late on in your careers, but I would have had the privilege of working with you and getting to know you. And I suppose I'm not surprised in a way what you've done. This was entirely all voluntary, by the way, folks, for those of you that don't know. You could have gone away and retired and gone off to Spain and all of these places, and I know you do that anyway. But you took on a remarkable piece of work in doing this. And what you've achieved is incredible, really. Because this story wouldn't be told otherwise. And I suppose it's hard to put it for me to put into words what you've achieved. But for me, I suppose you've captured an era that spans over three centuries, I suppose, going back to, as Audrin says, 1855, when the doors of the hospital opened. And you've captured, I suppose, you know, remarkable developments in both medical science and, I suppose, how care developed in that time, because that's, in essence, what it was about, and how that developed and evolved in tandem with, you know, developments in pharmacology and in medical and nursing care. And I suppose places like St. Loman's, particularly as I suppose in the 70s, 80s, would have had some bad press. And probably rightly so in some ways, because, you know, we were a little slow in moving towards a new model. But I suppose it's, you know, in my experience, it's testament to people like yourselves that made things better for the residents who lived there through your dedication and your commitment, and I suppose to use the ethical principles of beneficence and non-maleficence, so to do good, to do no harm, and you all encapsulate that, and that culture was evident to me when I came here in 2002, that everyone here, your interests were driven by the residents, no matter what you came to us for, it was always about the residents. I suppose I'll round it up by there, and just again to say thank you on behalf of hospital management, and we're delighted to have this memorial here now, which is a wonderful piece, I think you'll all agree, and will be there for a long time to come. So thank you all very much, guys. Now, in writing this book, we try to write this book from the perspective of the staff. We try to show, obviously, the bits of said, the bits about the history and the building, show all that type of stuff. But we also try to say or see where the staff of the hospital integrated in the town, how they affected the town, or vice versa. And we could easily see that over the years with, say, sport, with the GAA, we saw with the pitch and push. We saw with, say, music, with the pantomimes, the shows every year in the old county hall, just to mention a few. Over the years, when the mental hospitals were being built, it was sought after by some big towns because it was going to be a major employer and it was going to have a major effect on the local economies. And at one stage, County Meath were actually going to build their own asylum, until it was decided, no, to do more extensions here. So it took a full 125 years after that first proposal came before they stopped admitting people from County Meath. So they didn't work that very, very, very fast. We're indebted to a lot of people, certainly, firstly, maybe the traders in town who sold the book without any, just at cost price, without any question. And I'd like to mention them, maybe Martin's Quick Pick, Millie Walsh at the Dublin Bridge, Just Books, Eason's and Rochford's, and certainly they were a great help to us. Also, I think Catherine Graham here in reception was probably a great anchor woman when someone came looking for the book. Those that helped us are I know really acknowledged in the book, but to Julia Smith, to Jennifer Nolan, without you girls, the hours and hours of work that you put into it is something else. Now, getting it, commissioning it, paying for it, say, as I said, from the profits of the book was one bit, but it just didn't come here of its own accord. I know Christy Dalton is there. Christy did a lot of the handiwork around here. Thank you, Christy. Kevin Gavigan. Then I know, Tim, maybe we threw this on you the other day, Patricia Kavanagh, and Kevin as well. I know both Kevin and Patricia, when you came here, this was a project long done, and probably the first you may have heard of it when we came in and said, well, here it is, where are we going to put it? So just to both you, thanks for your help and cooperation. And, you were delighted to have it. As I say, it's a lovely piece. It really does commemorate those people that lived, that were cared for, and that died here, as well as the other worked here. So can we just, in remembrance of them, can I just ask for maybe take a minute of silence, a minute to reflect, even a private prayer, just to remember those people who died and are buried here.
I enjoyed working on this piece. It was lovely to be contacted by the authors of the book, The History of St. Loman's, and especially the fact that I had a family link to St. Loman's in that both my parents worked here for years, and a lot of my uncle also worked here. So there's a family connection to St. Loman's as well. So it was lovely to, as I say, be commissioned by the group and to work on this nice memorial sculpture that'll be here for a long time to come.
And the process, how long?
Well, I suppose there's the design stage, and the six of us sat down and we thrashed around ideas, and we slowly came to a broad agreement on all the symbolism that we used. It took a little bit of time, and sometimes a piece like this, a memorial piece, is always going to take time because you want to get the symbols right and you want to get the message right. So the meetings were actually enjoyable affairs, in that there wasn't one person trying to kind of force ideas on other people. We all came there together. So that was an important part of the journey. But that takes a certain amount of time. And once you have the design, the physical work of actually doing it took probably, I think, 3 weeks, 3 to 4 weeks it took me to do it. And then the installation.
What type of wood?
It's native oak, native white oak. I deal with a sawmill over there in Tullamore, so I think the tree was actually cut in around Portlaoise, the oak tree itself. So yeah. Thank you.
Yeah, and it's really oak is long lasting.
Oh yeah, yeah, and especially when it's maintained and looked after, you know, a little bit of maintenance every couple of years, and it should last plenty a long time to come. Yeah.
It deserves to be on call.
I'd say there'd be lots of people ringing
and in. Folks, before you all go, just to let you know, there are books still available to be for sale down the Springfield Centre.
I did it before, once we put four.